Nothing about the career of Jon Favreau has gone to plan. Starting as a young comic, all he wanted to do was land a gig on Saturday Night Live and then maybe end up in a sitcom. None of that happened. Instead, he lucked out when he wrote an indie comedy movie called Swingers that sold for a whopping $5 million. Since then, Jon Favreau has crafted a career both in front of and behind the camera. As a director, he fought to give Robert Downey Jr. the role of a lifetime as Iron Man. He gave Will Ferrell his first big screen hit in Elf. He even starred in and directed the award-winning film Chef. And now he's directed an ambitious live-action version of Walt Disney's The Jungle Book.
Cut.
It's all weird. I mean, there's nothing not weird about my career, but it's good weird. Like, I like weird. It's a good kind of weird.
Look at that.
You know, variety allows you to, it allows you to dive into the next thing with an enthusiasm where you don't get bored very easily. And I've been working on this thing almost 3 years, and this is weird coming back here. Last time I was here in Sydney was promoting Iron Man before anybody had seen it, before it ever screened.
And how much your life has changed.
Yeah, how much has changed. And I remember feeling the way I feel now about Jungle Book of like, I like it. Are they going to like it? You know, I've been involved with enough successes and failures to know that you can't predict ahead of time what's going to happen.
The gigantic Marvel empire wouldn't be the empire that it is today if it weren't for you and some very key decisions that you made very early on, most importantly casting Robert Downey Jr.
Yes.
Was that a big debate about casting a guy who was so risky at that point?
Yeah, and it was, and I think I had the wherewithal even at that time to know that if you get this guy in this movie, a lot of your job's done.
And was there pushback at that point? Because it was a very precarious point in Marvel's history.
Well, he was a little older than what we were looking at. And
I'm just not the hero type, clearly.
Nobody questioned his talent, but fortunately, and it's a real testament to Robert, and Robert said, this is my part.
Let's face it, this is not the worst thing you've caught me doing.
Even when I told him it's probably not going to happen, he's like, I think it will.
Did he register how important that would be a defining moment in his career?
Oh, he knew. He had a vision for it. He went in there, he screen tested, he destroyed. There was no argument, and was so inexpensive to hire that Marvel couldn't say no.
I bet he's not inexpensive now.
Not inexpensive now.
You're a chef. This is what you've been cooking for years, and it works.
I love the story about how when you were making Chef, when you're doing sound mixing every day, is it true that you would, as a crew, you would make the food that you saw?
We would. You know, we were mixing and there was a big commercial kitchen there and we were getting so hungry watching so somebody would go out and shop. I'd list all the ingredients because I learned to cook everything for the movie. And together we would go around this big table and all these big stoves and we'd cook each meal from the movie. And I had so much fun there that I actually put a kitchen that looks like a restaurant kitchen in my house. And so now that's what I do when I have people over. We do that same thing. We'll pick a recipe, smoke some brisket, stir fry, or Cuban sandwiches.
Does cooking for you have a meditative quality?
Now it does. It wasn't something I enjoyed that much earlier. I always loved food. But I really love the idea that even the most mundane task, if you are completely engaged and mindful of it, is both meditative and also leads to a good practice for how you approach your work, whatever you do. So I learned a lot from watching the chefs. It really helped me become a better filmmaker.
I might not do everything great in my life. Okay, I'm not perfect. I'm not the best husband. And I'm sorry if I wasn't the best father. But I'm good at this. And I want to share this with you.
If there's one running theme that runs throughout your movies, it seems to be family, but specifically an acquired family that you put together. Is that something that you recognize as being resonant for you?
No, I'm thinking about it now as you say it. I see that with Elf very much. I see it with Iron Man to some extent. Yeah, there is definitely a sense of loneliness and belonging that seems to pop up.
No matter where you go or what they may call you, you will always be my son.
Why do you think that is? Why do you think they are recurring themes for you?
I don't know. I think, you know, for me, an only child, there was, you know, I dealt with things, hardships younger with death and divorce and things like that. Your deepest memories inform what you're drawn to. You know, I find with most filmmakers, it's not always consciously intended. Think of how you feel when you see a picture of yourself or look yourself in a three-way mirror.
Curl into a ball and pretend it never happened.
It's awful for everybody. But you could usually trace it all the way back to early experiences to figure out how people end up doing what they do for a living and how their relationships play out, what kind of parents they are.
I don't care that you're an elf. I don't care that you're nuts. I don't care that you're my son. Get out of my life now.
I did want to ask you about Elf, because you were filming Elf in New York City right after
9/11. Yeah.
What was the mood like there?
I was mad. Everybody was very on edge, but I was like, no, I grew up with, you know, this is Miracle on 34th Street. This is, you know, Empire State Building. This is that New York is about this.
And everybody about returning innocence to the city.
I did. Yeah. It felt like with Will Ferrell going through an elf costume, it was like, I was very proud that we were going back to the city and making a fairy tale.
Just lastly, before I leave you, I did want to ask you about Jungle Book. Jungle Book does feature one very amazing actor who's no longer with us, which is Gary Shandling.
Yeah.
For somebody that actually knew Gary Shandling, what is it that the world has lost? What was his gift?
It's still kind of, you know, it's not that long ago. So it feels a little odd to be thinking about it in those terms. But everybody knew what he did in front of the camera. That's no secret. How he changed television with the Larry Sanders Show. But he was such a vital force behind the scenes. You'd show him your movie when it was done. He'd be one of the first guys that people, not just me, but a lot of people would show their work to. And he was always encouraging, but critical in the most helpful way. He really was a binding force that connected so many people from disparate aspects of show business that all overlapped and would go to his house to play basketball or an event or a family function.
Was he good at basketball?
Yeah, he was quite an athlete and boxing too. See, these are things you don't know about the guy, but he was and was in great shape too, took very good care of himself. So that's why it's so shocking that we lose him so early, because he was he felt so alive and so vital. It's very sad and sobering.
John Favreau, thank you so much for talking to us. Really appreciate your time.